This video is about my jointer that is as old as my bands are and was made by the same company Krumrein & Katz in Stuttgart-Feuerbach. Its motor was damaged beyond repair and it was out of use since more than 30 years. And it had a hard time while we took down the roof of this part of the workshop. But sometimes the jointer had some fun serving as a sideboard on workshop parties. When I rearranged the workshop completely, I had the idea to set the jointer on tracks so that it could be used in the middle of the shop when necessary, but otherwise near the wall. What will I need for that project? Let's see. An iron platform with wheels, 16 meters of vinyl rails, some planks and blocks and dowels for handling, and of course two new motors with flat belts. First, we installed the rails with their top almost flush with the floor. I made sure that they were perfectly horizontal and with a track gauge of 92 centimeters. I made a groove beside the rails for the wheel flanges. Then I prepared the wheels for the platform. I didn't use ball bearings because I wanted to keep things simple. The wheels are very thick, so the area of contact with the shaft is big enough to support the weight of the jointer without risking too much wear on the shaft. I really enjoyed working with these wheels. I hadn't known that those were still produced. They look like something from the 19th century. At some point, the whole jointer on platform project may have looked as if it was only a welcome excuse to pretend to have a small railway factory. Then came a very time-consuming task, lifting the jointer onto the platform. It's technically simple, but has to be done step by step. First bringing it up, then sliding, or better, rolling it sideways on rows of dowels. When that was done, I tried to move the platform. I had to push with considerable force, but it moved nice and smooth. Then the motors had to be installed. There are two pulleys. The lower and bigger one is for the thickness planer. If the belt was switched from the idle pulley on the left side to the fixed pulley, the gears started to drive the feed mechanism. The upper and smaller pulley is sitting directly on the shaft of the cutter head. The old motor drove both by using a step pulley on its shaft, but I wanted two separate motors instead, so I could avoid the combination of a very big pulley and a very small pulley on the motor shaft. The considerable difference in rotation speed is now realized by using a 3000 RPM and a 1000 RPM motor. I used a laser to find out the exact orientation of the cutter shaft. Then I set this laser perpendicular to this axis and aligned the motors corresponding to the position of the upper pulleys. It's important to look after the bearings if a machine was out of use for such a long time, especially if it was given to you with its motor blown by overload. But the bearings seem to be okay. These Babbitt bearings are made of brass and don't show any sign of overheating. the oil pulling ring runs free, and by adding some oil, this should be all right. The heavy cast iron fence is held by two big screws, as usual, on the infeed table. Oh, the cutter head definitely deserves some attention before starting the jointer. There are three blades mounted with hex nuts. Everything is a bit rusty here, but the blades at least don't show any nicks and seem to be sharp enough to give it a try. A quick look after the mechanism that lowers the infeed table. Then power on. Okay, 20mm sprues isn't the proper test for this jointer. Let's do some 20 centimeters ash, taking away 3 millimeters. So the jointer seems to work as it is supposed to. But that's only half of the machine. There is still the thickness planer to be put into operation. The mechanism that lifts the lower table is driven by this shaft over a bevel gear. Let's turn the handle.
So I will have to get all of this going again before I can use the thickness planer, and I think mending this will make a new video.